Hello and welcome back to the channel. You join me in the beautiful Sardinian countryside. This place is absolutely stunning and I am on the launch of the new Royal Enfield Himalayan 450. And in this video, I'm going to tell you exactly what this motorcycle is like to ride. I have been really excited about this launch because I couldn't wait to get behind the bars of this motorcycle. Now, I've ridden the previous Himalayan briefly. The old man has ridden it a bit more than me, but I've ridden the Scram 411 quite a bit and they're very similar bikes. But this new Himalayan takes the essence of the old one and brings it to a whole new level. This is really next level compared to the old one. It is completely different and it is so much better. It's worlds apart. The feel of the bike when you get on it, you've got a lovely riding position. The bars are nice and wide. So for someone of my height, it's really, really comfortable. And I'll show you what I look like later on in the video on top of the bike. And this is a bike that I really would love to do some adventures on. We've done some incredible riding today out in the twisties, up in the mountains, some proper off-road riding, and this bike is very capable. The tyres that it comes with aren't the best tyres for off-roading. They're dual sport tyres, so they're mainly road biased because most of the riding people are going to be doing on these bikes is on the road. But if you change these to some proper knobblies, then you'd get a really good performing bike in the wet mud as well. Before we set off this morning, we connected our phones to the new TFT dash. So I know that sounds like something really odd to say about a Royal Enfield, that it's got a TFT screen. But it stays true to what they want their design to be. Royal Enfield are all about analog. They love an analog dial, and so do we on this channel. It's something we love because it's a work of art. Not only does it tell you your RPMs and your speed and etc., but the way you can make it a thing of beauty is just something that adds to the feel of the bike. But as TFT screens go, this is by far the best one I've ever experienced. A lot of the time they look really fussy, they're quite sporty and angular. I don't like that at all, that's not my cup of tea. This is a lovely circular design, it's nice and sleek, it's got the Royal Enfield logo at the bottom, and it is a really good interface. It can pair with your phone on the Royal Enfield app, and you can cast your maps through Google Maps onto the screen so you can see exactly where you're going. If you turn your phone screen off, however, it will turn the maps off on the screen. So you have to keep your phone screen open. So that will kind of drain your battery a bit, but not to worry, because you have got a very sleek USB-C port on the handlebars. So if your phone's getting low, you can plug it in and have it in your pocket or whatever you fancy doing. You've got three different designs on the screen as well. You've got a digital mode, which is a much more modern layout. And then you've got analog mode, which looks like a traditional Royal Enfield dial, but in an old school style. Sorry, someone else is going past me on a Himalayan. But yeah, it really does stay true to their classic design, but obviously it is a screen, so it's not as beautiful or as much of a work of art as an analog dial can be, but it's as close as you're going to get with a digital display. And to have that usability and the functions that this gives you, it really is it's good to have on an adventure bike, because it also gives you alerts. For example, if you're running low on fuel, it will come up with an alert, and it will also ask you if you want to navigate to the nearest petrol station. It will tell you exactly where the nearest petrol station is, so you can just say accept on this little joystick on the side, and then it will take you to the nearest petrol station. I think that is an absolutely brilliant idea, and I've not seen anyone else do that in the motorcycle industry. So hats off to Royal Enfield. Those of you with a keen eye will have noticed that I'm wearing one of our new t-shirts. So we've got a new design of merch that's out now. It's way better than anything we've done before, if you ask me. And that's because I got someone else to design it, my girlfriend to be specific. She happens to be quite good at graphic design, so I'm very happy with her. But if you are interested in one of these t-shirts, we've got them in white and black with a slightly different colour design on them. You've got an awesome back print as well, which I'm over the moon with. So if you like classic motorcycles, you'll love this t-shirt. So if you want to check them out, click onto the channel and head over to the store section and you can get yourself one. And also, if you do get yourself one, then tag us in a photo or send us a photo on Instagram and we'll certainly share it over on our story. But if you don't want to help support the channel in that way, you can subscribe, which is absolutely free. We're on the road to 100,000 subscribers, so if you could click subscribe, that would help us out massively. As I got onto the bike, the first thing I noticed was how light it is compared to the previous model. It weighs 196 kilograms with the fuel in it, or 90% of the fuel in it. The seat is also a really nice height, but you've got two different settings on the seat. There's a low and a high seat as well. So there's two different seat options and each of them are adjustable in two different positions. I'll put the actual millimeters of that on the screen now because there's no way I'm gonna remember four different figures in one go. My brain's not good enough. Now, the engine, as I said, is way more fun than the previous one. It's so much better. And for all the people who complained that the previous model was too slow, it was underpowered, you will love this bike because it's a whole new level. The 450cc Sherpa single cylinder engine produces 40 PS at 8,000 RPM and 40 newton meters of torque at 5,500 RPM. But this thing has a really nice linear torque curve and power curve, so it pulls very smoothly throughout the RPM range. And it produces more torque at 2,500 RPM than the previous model did at any point in the rev range, which is remarkable. So when you're going up steep hills, which we've done a lot of today, up these mountain passes, it just pulls and pulls. They don't at any point feel like it's sluggish. It will accelerate up the hills with no problem whatsoever. Whereas the previous one would have been bogging down. You'd have to change down a gear. You'd have to wring the neck out of each gear to get up a steep hill, whereas this absolutely won't. Around town, it's perfectly comfortable at low RPMs. It doesn't bog down. So if you're at 2,500 RPM, you're going around a hairpin or you're in a small traffic scenario, then this bike is just at home. So the ease of riding is unbelievable. The slipper assist clutch, the clutch lever is very light. So it's really easy to get on with for a new rider, but for experienced riders, it's also great fun as well. So you could buy this bike as your first sort of bike for doing some adventuring or green laning, and you could keep it for many years and still be absolutely over the moon with it. I do think if I was going to get a bike for green laning, this would absolutely be the one. This video is sponsored by Bikeshore. Both myself and the old man have been using Bikeshore for a number of years now, and they can find you a policy no matter how normal your bike is or how crazy it is, whether it's highly modified or standard like the bike in this video, they can find you a policy. They also offer multi-bike policies as well, so if you've got more than one bike and you want them all on the same policy, that's something they can offer. Now, if you click the link in our description, it will take you through to their website where you can get a tailored quote for you. One thing I worried about with this new liquid-cooled engine is if it would have as much character as the outgoing 411 motor. And it does still retain a lot of the character, and it's a really nice sounding bike when you start it up. It's got a lovely thump to it. The exhaust is actually pretty good sounding for a standard exhaust. They are also working on a sort of OEM aftermarket exhaust with aero, so that'll be a little bit more throaty and a different tone, but it still meets all the regulations, so it's not going to be loud, but then I'm sure there will be plenty of aftermarket options out there very soon to really open up the sound of this bike. But I really do love this engine, it is fantastic. Now, when you are up in the twisties, the handling is superb. It really is a fun bike in those twisty lanes, and the beauty of it is that a lot of these roads, you have potholes and little bumps and undulations, and this soaks them up absolutely brilliant. The suspension, the shower forks on the front, upside down forks, and the monoshock on the rear are absolutely brilliant. And off-road as well, they are superb. So any bumps and big troughs and ruts, it goes over them fantastically. So I'm really impressed with those. The brakes are also fantastic. Single disc on the front and a single on the rear. These are Bibry brakes, so by Brembo, but they are really, really good and definitely better than the previous version's brakes. I do think this is a good looking motorcycle. I perhaps don't think it's quite as good looking as the outgoing version. The shape of the tank I'm not 100% sold on yet, but it might be one of those designs that grows on me over time. But what I love about Royal Enfield, and the chief designer said this himself last night, is that they don't want to put any pointy, sharp, angular things or plastic parts on the bike to cover up bits. This whole tank is a metal thing that's been sculpted. You know, they sculpted it in a clay model to start with to see what it would look like. And everything's about smooth, beautiful lines. So they do that very well. And they're one of the only ones who still make motorcycles beautifully these days. But yeah, they really are knocking it out of the park. It is a good looking bike, but personally, I think perhaps not quite as good looking as the old one. The engine's a very good looking thing as well. As with most Royal Enfield engines, they are a work of art. Something else I wanted to cover about this engine is how it compares to the Triumph 400 engine, because they're very similar in terms of performance figures, but they do feel slightly different. Perhaps this has got more pickup on the lowdown, but it was a few months ago that I rode those 400 models. So if you want to see a comparison between this bike and perhaps the Scrambler 400X, then do let us know in the comments below. But I also asked the Royal Enfield chaps last night, the guy who designed the engine, and I said, do you have any plans to put this engine into other models? And he said, rather cheekily, maybe. So I think if you look at previous trends and what Royal Enfield brought out after the Himalayan with the same engine, then you can kind of see where they're going with it and what might be coming out in the near future. Now, I've got the seat set to the higher setting, which is 845 millimeters, and I am 6'1", and this is what I look like on the motorcycle. So it really is a good riding position. It's a very comfortable bike for someone over 6 foot, but also people under 6 foot can get on well with it because they can get the lower seat option, which goes down to about 805 millimeters. So you've got a fair bit of difference there. But yeah, as you can see, the riding position is lovely. I can see most of the road with the mirrors. They're nice and wide. The screen, you've got a lovely screen on the front which does protect you from the wind very nicely. The side stand is quite a little bit of a lean, but I think that's very good because if you put this bike facing sort of uphill slightly, then it's not going to topple over easily. But you've also got a center stand, which a lot of you will be very pleased to know. The bike also has two modes, which are performance and eco mode. To be honest with you, I've only used performance mode so far, but also within those modes, you can turn the rear ABS off. So when you're going off road, you can switch that off. That's a really good feature to have. Got this rear seat rack as well, which is nice and handy. Everything is designed with real good quality, and it's remarkable for the price because this bike comes in the base colour just under £6,000. I think it's about £5,800, and even the most expensive one is about £6,300. So it's so much bike for the money, and it really is unbelievable how they do it. But they do it again and again and again, and it is always a surprise. But I probably shouldn't be surprised because what do you expect? It's Royal Enfield. They also are coming out with a lot of accessories for this bike, so you can really make it your own. And Royal Enfield really do encourage customization, so I'm sure there will be lots of aftermarket parts available for this bike to really make it your own. Royal Enfields have a certain way about them. They make you feel fantastic when you're on the back of them. It's all to do with the character, the beauty of the motorcycle, the places it takes you. You just kind of go where the wind blows you, to be honest, on a bike like this. It's one of those bikes you could just get on, go out for a ride and just see where you end up, because you just have so much fun. And then if you did get lost, you could connect back up to the tripper nav and sat nav home. That's a good fun task, so definitely something I'd recommend doing. But it really is fantastic. It's so easy to use, it's nicely laid out, everything is just remarkable. And Royal Enfield just emote something in me, I don't know what it is, but I've been smiling all day today and I do actually really like this bike, but I'd definitely be interested to see what they come up with next with this engine, because that could be something I enjoy even more than this. So we've got to stay tuned and see what they come up with. I'm so excited. So overall then, this is really a bike I would recommend as an adventure bike. If I was going to get one, this would be it, because it's not too heavy, it's got plenty of oomph, it's comfortable, I'd be perfectly happy doing long distance rides on this bike. It's pretty good looking, the mudguards are actually functional, the 6-speed gearbox has a lovely positive feel to it, it's got plenty of character, and the performance is certainly there. So for the money as well, there is nothing else on the market that I would want apart from this in this sector. They really have done a great job. If you've enjoyed this review, please do leave a like, leave your comments down below what you think of this new Himalayan, and we will see you in the next video.